Thank you, Yasmina, for the introduction, and thank you for having me. Hello, everybody. Today I am going to present you our work on Hook is My Battery, Analyzing Mobile Browser Energy Consumption. This work is a joint collaboration work between Deutsche Telekom Innovation Laboratories, Silicon Valley Innovation Center, and the research group of Professor Dan Bonnet in Stanford University. So the first two authors on the presentation, you can see Narin and Gorov, has been my interns in our research lab here in Silicon Valley. Dan Bonnet has been their supervisor. I have been very closely working with all three of them. And Jatinder Pal Singh has been working with us in our Deutsche Telekom research lab when the work has been done. Now, let me start with the motivation of our work. So over the last years, there has been an explosion of mobile devices and data traffic. According to Cisco Global Mobile Data Traffic Forecast, by 2015, there will be $788 million mobile-only internet users, and also by then, the global mobile traffic will increase by a factor of 26. Now, also according to Cisco's report, you know, more and more mobile devices will be on the market, and the prediction is that more than a quarter of mobile users will own two or more mobile connected devices by 2016. Now, also that 3% of all worldwide web browsing is done on a mobile browser according to Net Market Share report. Now, despite the explosive growth of the smartphones and growing popularity of mobile web browsing, their utility has been and will remain severely limited by the battery life. Now, today, the energy is the single most important factor lagging these smartphones. So the smartphone's energy constraints are here to stay, and optimizing the energy consumption of the phone browser while surfing the web is of critical importance today and will remain in the future. Now, today, you know, more and more devices become more and more powerful. They have more and more powerful applications. They have more demands. A lot of powerful, you know, video and streaming applications demands are appearing on the market. So with more devices becoming increasingly feature and function rich, the energy demand had been growing at a much faster rate than what the batteries can safely deliver. So on the right side of the slide, you can see a graph which shows the relative performance improvements over the years, and this has been published by Chalamala in Proceedings of IEEE in 2007. And you can see in the graph that basically the graph compares the performance improvements in storage devices, in CPUs, and against improvements in the energy density of batteries. And as you can see in the graph, it shows a slow battery energy density growth. So while there has been a significant improvement in the energy density and capacity of batteries, it has not kept the pace with improvements similar to those achievements in other electronic components such as hard disk and CPUs and so forth. So now, having this motivation, let me start with our work. So despite the growing popularity of the mobile web browsing, the energy consumed by a phone browser while surfing the web is poorly understood. So many popular websites provide today a mobile version of their site optimized for a small screen. As you can see on the left side of the slide, there are several examples of the mobile website. As you can see, Gmail has a mobile website, Picasa, CNN, and so forth. However, we show in our work that many mobile websites are poorly optimized for energy use, and rendering them takes more energy than necessary. So basically, the phone utility is limited by the battery life. Now, the key question here is how to intelligently design the web pages to reduce the energy consumption. And for this, we came up with our software infrastructure for measuring the precise energy used by a mobile browser. So to render the web pages, and also we developed techniques to load browser heavy computation to the cloud. Now the big challenge here is how much energy does the phone use to render a particular web page? And in our work, we show how the structure of web pages can impact battery usage in mobile web browser. And we show how to design the web pages to minimize the energy needed for rendering the web pages. So for this, we develop novel techniques and tools to precisely measure the energy needed to render individual web elements. And we have looked into web elements such as images, JavaScript, CSS, as well as plugin objects. And we design a system that has the potential to dramatically reduce power consumption of smartphones. So, great. Now, we start the next, we are looking into slide number five. Today, the mobile devices support a high-level API for finding out the battery level, but provide no support for obtaining precise fine-grained energy use. So for that, we basically take a high-precision digital multimeter, as you can see on the slide, on the left side, and we open a battery of a mobile device, as you can see in the figure, and we hook the multimeter to the phone battery that measures the phone's energy consumption as the phone loads and renders the web pages. So on the right side of the slide, you can see the high power interval, which captures the browser activity. In this example, you can see a sample multimeter output graph for a Facebook page, and the high power interval captures the browser activity. As you can see in this example, we used rendering a Facebook web page. Now, what we are looking is to how to measure precisely the energy used for processing a web page, which includes rendering individual elements, web elements such as images, JavaScript, CSS, and plugin objects. Great. So, in addition to the hardware setup, we had to modify the default Android browser. So this, in the next slide, we show the system architecture of our infrastructure, which has a layered architecture and a modular design that contains a browser profiler on top, and we modify the Android browser itself. So now the modified browser enables us to fully load a URL in one of the two modes, no cache and with cache. Now, the no cache mode shows the browser cache is basically emptied before starting to load the URL, so that all elements of the web page are first downloaded from the network and then rendered on the phone. So in this mode, we basically measure the total energy used for navigating to the page, including the cellular 3G transmission, parsing the HTML page, as well as rendering the page. The second mode is a with cache mode. And in this mode, all elements of the web page are already present in the browser cache, so that there is no need to use the radio to basically download any content. So in this mode, it lets us measure the energy needed to parse and render the HTML from the cache. So there is no cellular traffic in this mode. Now, as a next step, we had some modifications in the cache management system of the Android default browser. We are able to intercept the page load for each page loaded into a browser. We have implemented several track metrics to measure the time for loading a web page, to count all the links to specific web elements and components into a web page, and so forth. So when recording samples with a multimeter, there should be a minimal interaction with the phone to ensure accurate measurements. And to achieve this, we basically modify the browser to ask user permission to start loading the page by displaying a dialogue. So into the next slide, we show you an automatic energy measurement system. So basically, the energy measurement system described before requires significant user assistance in the measurement process. So the user has to, you know, push the button and say, yes, okay, and now the page is going, the multimeter is going to be set up and ready for measurement. And then once the page starts to load, the measurement, the multimeter is going to measure the energy consumed by loading and rendering the web page. And now we were looking into how to automate this energy measurement system. So to perform a large number of measurements, we automated the process by using the SCPI programming interface on the multimeter. So we use a standard command for programmable instruments. So we were able to set up this automated system. And you can see on the left side, you have the digital multimeter that is hooked to an open battery. As well, we have on the right side a laptop, which is basically running a server and is communicating with the multimeter and with the mobile device. Now, in the next slide, you can see basically how the entire system, automatic energy measurement system, works. So basically, we have three components: a multimeter, a server running on our laptop, and an Android mobile phone. So first, the server controls the phone and the multimeter, and the server communicates with the browser profiler on the phone. And the server instructs the browser profiler to request the running phone browser to repeatedly load a specific URL, and in either the two modes, with cache or without cache. And the server is the one who controls and starts the multimeter measurement, and then send a request to the mobile phone to basically load the URL. And once the URL starts and load, the measurement is starting, and all the measurements are recorded on the multimeter and automatically transferred to the server for proceeding. And then the next step is repeated, and the next URL is loaded, and so forth. So we succeeded to do an automatic energy measurement system, which allows us to basically measure a large number of energy measurements. Now, in order to start and present you the detailed energy measurements that we have done on loading and rendering the web pages, we looked first into the energy consumption for downloading and uploading data over 3G cellular network. So as you can see on the graph, it shows you the energy consumption for different data, for different data sizes from 4 kilobytes up to 256 kilobytes over cellular network. So we show the average energy needed for downloading and uploading from 4 kilobytes up to 256 over 3G in our case. So the experiment basically separates the upload activity from the download activity. And in the graph, you can see the red line. It shows the energy consumption for downloading the data over 3G. So the red line is over is uploading the data over 3G network. And the blue line shows the energy consumption for downloading the data over 3G cellular network. Now, the upload numbers are obtained by sending data from the phone and not using the radio for any other task. And downloading the numbers are obtained in a similar way. Now, as you probably know, a web browser sends HTML requests and receives HTML responses using multiple threads as it requests and receives various components that make up basically a web page. So this figure that we show here can be used to model an application that mostly use one-way communication, such, for example, a streaming video application. And this figure should not be used when there are many round trips. And from our work and results and experience, we realized that basically it can be quite difficult to define an energy model that accurately predicts the 3G energy needed to fetch a web page, since energy use depends on the precise shape of the traffic. Now, as you can see in the graph, there is a setup cost, actually is a high setup cost of roughly 12 joules before the first byte can be sent. So this is the communication setup cost, that this comes the first time before actually any page can be downloaded and then rendered on the mobile device. So as you can see in the graph, the download energy is basically mostly flat up to 256 kilobytes, and the upload energy is increases with the amount of data being uploaded. So in our next experiment, we have derived all the data from real energy measurement, and we have not used any model to estimate the radio energy needed to fetch a web page. Okay, so now I'm going to present you the first set of experiments that we have done to measure the energy consumption of top websites. So our first experiment measures the energy consumption used by web pages at several top websites. In our case, there are 25 most used and popular websites worldwide. We choose these sites representing social networking, e-commerce, email, blogging, news portals, and financial websites. And to measure this total energy to download and render the web page, we first measured the phone's average energy consumption when the browser is idle. And as you can see on the slide, the average power consumption when the browser is idle is 170 milliwatts. So the web page is to be, so basically there is this average power consumption of 170 milliwatts, which we subtract from any other measurements that are going to be presented in this paper. So this is the basically borderline. Now, the figure is generated from the mobile version of the website, and as you can see on the slides, that the exceptions are basically apple.com, tumblr.com, Blogger, and WordPress. This website, at the time when we did that measurement, they did not have a mobile website version. So as a result, the amount of data needed to retrieve these sites is significantly higher than for other websites. And just to give you an example, as you can see on the right side, Apple is the most energy consumption website in our measurement. And the reason for that is that Apple page contains many images, including a 26 kilobyte welcome image that is mostly wasted on the phone, since the phone scales down to fit with small screen. Now let's go into more detail. So, but before I go to the next experiment, it's important to keep in mind here that this graph shows the energy consumption to download and render the web page, which includes the energy for 3G communication, parsing the web page, as well as rendering the web page. And in the next slide, I'm going to show you the energy consumption for rendering web pages of the top websites. So now what we did in this experiment is we measured the energy used to parse and render the page when all components are already in the memory. So to measure the rendering energy, we forced the browser to basically locally cache all web components and then measured how much energy was used to render the content from the local cache. So we only, as you can see in this slide, we only included 10 sites out of 25 in total. And for the remaining 15 sites, caching web component did not prevent the network traffic. So In the figures, in the figure on the slide, we show you the energy consumption for 10 of these websites, and the percentages above the bars show the energy to render the web page as a fraction of the total energy to download and render the page. And in all our experiments, we noticed that the JavaScript and CSS at this website basically generated dynamic web requests that could not be cached ahead of time. So just to give you an example, on the Apple homepage, the JavaScript used for tracking user location generate an update forcing the phone to set up a 3G connection. So basically, despite caching, the energy consumption for these 10 websites was almost as high as when no caching basically took place. So here is a very important lesson to keep in mind for developers which basically build and design a mobile website. And the lesson is that dynamic JavaScript can greatly increase the power usage of a web page. And now the big question and the big challenge here is how much energy is used by different web elements. And this is what we have looked into in the next experiment that we have done. So to measure the energy used by a particular element, we created a copy of the web page on our servers and then compared the energy consumption used by, you know, loading and rendering the entire page to the energy consumption needed for loading and rendering the page with the particular component removed by basically commenting it out. So on the slide, you can see I'm going to present you the energy consumption for a web element of type images. And on the right side of the slide, you can see the energy consumption of web elements of type JavaScript. So in both cases, so we measure the energy consumption with a web page which contains this elements and of our web pages which do not contain these elements. And the difference between these numbers give an estimate for the energy need to present the component. So let's start with the images. On the figure on the left side, it shows the energy measurement for images on the web page. And the bars on the right correspond to the total energy spent on images, and the bars on the left side shows the rendering energy for cached images. And the percentage above the left bar shows the energy spent on rendering images as a fraction of the energy for rendering the entire page from the cache. So, as expected, rendering images takes a significant fraction of the total rendering energy. And let's give you a couple of examples. In case of YouTube, as you can see on the slide, the YouTube spends around a quarter of their rendering energy on images. And the amount of image used, the amount of energy used to render the images is proportional to the number of size and number and size of images on the web page. So in case of YouTube, YouTube has five large images rendering a screenshot for each video, and this is the reason why 24.22% in our case of the total energy to render the page is spent on images. Now let's give you another example. In case of Gmail, as you can see on the left side of the graph, Gmail in contrast contains only small GIF images. It's about 13 pixels wide, and the images take a smaller fraction of the total energy, and this is around 6.86%. Now, Picasa, in case of Picasa, there is spent a large fraction of its rendering energy, which is about 20.56% on images, and because the user album page contains 8 large album cover images. So, these are some examples and why the energy is consumed in case of these websites. Now let's go to the JavaScript. In case of JavaScript, we consider only Amazon, Picasa website, YouTube, and Yahoo, because they did have a JavaScript. So you can see, first we measure the rendering energy, and the right column represents the total energy, which includes transmission and rendering. So let's go into detail. So in case of Amazon, the Amazon consumes 16.89% of its rendering energy for handling the JavaScript. And the reason for that is that the large rendering cost is a large and complex Java file. And many of the JavaScript functions in the file are not used by the page, but loading and proceeding the entire JavaScript file consumes a lot of energy. And that's something very important to know for the web developers. And another example is Yahoo's JavaScript code is embedded in the HTML page. And in this case, in case of Yahoo website, the amount of JavaScript code is very small, but the code gets executed every time when the page is loaded. So basically, as a result, there is 6.79% of the total rendering energy in case of Yahoo. So the JavaScript code here is minimal and is fully used in the page. Now, in case of YouTube, which you see on the right side of the graph, YouTube JavaScript is embedded, but is so heavy that it takes about 20.35% of the total energy. Now, in case of CSS, which I haven't shown on the slides, the rendering cost of CSS web elements depends on the number of items styled using CSS as well. Okay, so now let's go to the next graph of our presentation. So for completeness, the figure showed in this slide, it shows the relative cost of individual elements. So we put basically all the elements together, and you can see on the graph, the bottom part, the blue color, represents the energy consumption for images, the red part represents the energy consumption for CSS web elements, the green for JavaScript web elements, and the others, which is the purple. Now, this graph is another way of comparing the website efficiency. So the general trend across all these websites is that the CSS and JavaScript are the most energy-consuming components in the transmission and rendering of a site. Now, as you can see, there are a couple of websites that have others, which have a higher number, which in this case is the AOL website, the eBay website, as well as the Gmail website. So the sites that have these high others can become more efficient as the wireless technology improves and connection setup cost decreases. And you can also see on the graph that there are sites with the low others, for example, Apple and IMBD. And in this case, the sites with these low others spend much of their energy on the web components and will not gain much of from improvements in the wireless technology. Okay, so let's go to the next round of experiments. And in this round, we have looked basically on, we show how to optimize the web pages so as to reduce the power consumption of these elements. So in case of JavaScript, basically, in case of JavaScript, we notice that there is a high download and rendering energy cost. And just to refresh my mind and give you an example, I recall the download and rendering cost of JavaScript in case of Wikipedia page takes about 10 joules. And this is about 30% of the total energy to download and render the page. So this is quite a high cost. So one of optimization that that we suggest to web developers and recommend is basically shrinking the JavaScript on a mobile page to contain only functions used by the page would greatly reduce the energy cost. And in case of CSS, web elements, the CSS should be, you know, web page specific and contain only the rules required by the elements in the web page. So the large CSS files with unused CSS rules will consume more energy than minimum required on the mobile device. And this is basically a reason that is drying the battery on the mobile device. Now, let's go to the next slide. And in this slide, we will show a comparison and optimization in case of images web components. So most common image formats that are used on a mobile device are images of format JPEG, GIF, and PNG, and that's what we noticed from all our experiments. And now to give you an idea about where these type of images are used, the GIF format images were mostly used for very small images, such as small arrows and icons. The PNG files were used for larger images, such as banners and logos. And JPEG images were used for large images. Now, in the figure on the right side, you can see the energy consumption needed to download and render the images of different sizes in three formats on the Android phone. So in our experiment, we used a JPEG image of dimensions of 1,600 pixels per 1,200 pixels and a size of roughly 741 kilobytes. And smaller images of different height and weight are cropped from this image. And we then saved the cropped images as JPEG, GIF, and PNG. And each of these images was embedded into a web page that contained the image and nothing else. And as you can see in the graph, since basically the GIF format images and the PNG format images are, because they are only used for small images, we only experimented with these formats for small images. Now, our results, as you can see in the figure, it shows that the JPEG is the most energy-efficient format for image sizes. And something important to just give you more information here. So in order to do this conversion, we used a Mogrify tool to convert all images on the Amazon and Facebook pages to JPEG using a standard 92 quality compression measure. And then we then measured the relative energy consumption for rendering the resulting images from the cache relative to the original images. And you can see on the bottom of the slide, it shows our results. So the first line shows how much energy it consumes to render a web page which contains images of several formats, and this means the original website. In case of Amazon, it consumes 2.54 joules, and in case of Facebook, it consumes 3.43 joules. Now, if we convert all the images formats on Amazon and Facebook web pages into a JPEG format, we noticed that we save energy of 20% in case of Amazon and 30% in case of Facebook. So, as a result, both Amazon and Facebook can conserve energy on Android phones by converting their images to JPEG format without basically impacting the visible quality of the images. And the reason for that is that JPEG compresses the images better and is faster to render than PNG and GIF formats. Okay, so now let's go to the next step. In the next step of, you know, our experiments and that we have done in our work, we have looked at how to offload, you know, browser computation to the cloud. So given the phone's limited energy, there is a strong desire to minimize its work. So a natural idea is to offload heavy computations to a server cloud and have the phone display the results. Now, in the context of a web browsing, one could offload the image rendering, which includes, for example, decompression and conversion of a bitmap to the cloud and have the phone simply display the resulting bitmap. And some examples of this is Opera and Skyfire that take this approach. So basically, let me first summarize the two types of offloading browser computation. So the first one is offloading via a front-end proxy, as that this is basically a web proxy examines all traffic to the phone and partially renders the page, and the proxy decides how the context should be modified before it is sent to the phone. And the second type of offloading is basically via a backend proxy, where the phone downloads the web component and basically the offload certain operations. It's basically offloading certain operations to a backend server. And the phone decides what needs to be offloaded in this case. Now, in the first case, offloading via a front-end proxy, some browsers, as I briefly mentioned earlier, some browsers such as Opera and Skyfire take this approach. And their phone browsers talk to the web through a proxy that does most of the heavy lifting of rendering the web page. And now a fundamental challenge here is from estimating the point at which offloading browser computation to a backend remote server can save energy on the phone. And that's basically the big challenge here. Now, in our example, and one of the key examples here, and some websites, for example, like apple.com, do not have a mobile version. So the phones visiting these websites unnecessarily download large images. So a natural application for front-end proxy is, for example, at a carrier data center, where the carrier can optionally play the role of the proxy. Now, on the figure in the slide, on the right side, you can see the energy saving that shows basically the energy savings that results from a front-end proxy that downscale all images JPEGs to 160 pixel width. So the blue line represents the energy needed to download JPEG images of various sizes when no front-end proxy is used. And this line is basically generated using the same cropping setup using the previous experiment that I have already explained. Now, the green line that you can see on the graph, it shows the saving from a front-end proxy. And since all the images larger than 160 pixels are scaled down by the proxy, the energy beyond that image size is basically flat. So this shows the advantage of having a front-end proxy mechanism, basically offload the computation. Anything above the borderline is going to take advantage of offloading the mechanism. Now, from our experiments and deep experiments that we have done, we noticed that the backend offloading of image rendering is not a feasible solution with today's technology. Now, let's go to the next slide. And in the next slide, I'm going to summarize number of guidelines for designing the energy efficient websites based on our work and our results. And the first one that we notice is basically the JPEG is the best image format for the Android browser and holds for all image size, all image sizes. And that's something that we found very, very interesting, and we noticed this in all our experiments. Now, the second guideline that we suggest for web developers is basically using HTML links instead of JavaScript will greatly reduce the rendering energy for the web page. And just to give you an example, for example, Gmail, which is the most green mobile website that we found, it uses HTML links to open email messages that the user clicks on. And the desktop version of the Gmail uses JavaScript instead. Now, our experiments suggest that by basically using these links instead of JavaScript, greatly reduces the rendering energy for the page. And that's one of the important results that we had in our experiment. Now, another guideline that we suggest for web developers is using links to the third-party tools can greatly increase the power usage of the phone. So that's basically one of the important things that we notice in our experiments. And one of the key points we found is that a number of static pages that could have been locally cached and displayed without any network access. So we found this number of web pages. Unfortunately, this site basically linked to Google Analytics, which is all of them knows about it, is a tool that has to monitor the site usage. So the JavaScript used by this Google Analytics basically forces a dynamic network request that cannot be cached. So even though the site would have been rendered from the cache, the phone still has to pay the cost of setting up the cellular 3G connection in our case. So based on our work and our results, we really hope that that this will help the website and website developer understand the cost of linking to these third-party tools. And this is one of the key points basically that we notice and we provide you as a guideline. Now, another guideline that we mentioned and we noticed during our work is that using simple HTML table element to position elements on the page instead of CSS web elements saves the energy. So just to give you an example, the AOL is basically AOL website is able to save rendering energy by using a simple HTML table element to position these elements on the web page. And other sites that position elements using CSS need more energy to render these web pages. Now, of course, one of the key important things that we notice in order to save energy on mobile devices is building a mobile site optimizes for mobile devices conserves energy. And that's something one of the key points that we notice. And I gave you an example regarding the Apple website as well. So Apple.com was a particularly energy-hungry website. And we hope that our work demonstrate the importance of building a mobile website optimized for mobile devices. Sites that do not have a mobile version will basically drain the battery much faster, and this can potentially reduce. So this can potentially basically dry the battery much in a much faster way. Okay, so as a conclusion, I'm going to conclude my talk. So we showed that basically mobile web browsing on smartphones is energy hungry. And I showed you in this presentation a framework and tools for measuring the precise energy consumption of the web pages, including specific components on the page. And we looked into images, JavaScript, CSS, and plugin objects. We also estimated the efficiency of offloading browser-heavy computation to a backend remote server. And we show that basically by redesigning the website and by the website and the web pages, the energy consumption can be dramatically reduced. We also present you the guidelines for designing energy-efficient websites, and we presented a prototype of Android that we built an Android operating system, and the improvement in energy efficiency has been demonstrated in our presentation. So with this, I would like to thank you all for your attention, and I'm happy to get your questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nicolata, for an outstanding presentation for us today. We do have many questions that have come in. So, folks, we will take as many questions as we have time for, and we will take them in the order they have come in. We'll take the first question from Eason. He asks, will your monitoring tool be shared with us?
Great question. So the tools that we have implemented and developed, we haven't made them available publicly so far. Our plan is to do so, but we haven't made them publicly available as open source till today.
Thank you. Next question from David. Android 2.1 is pretty old at this point. Have you repeated your tests with Android 4.2?
So that's a great question. So the, when we started to do this work, it was, you know, about 2 years back, and we at that time, you know, we worked on the Android 2.1 version, and you know, our work has been presented and published in the World Wide Web conference in Lyon, in France, in 2012. We have not tested our work and experiments on the latest version of Android. We are continuously, you know, looking into continuously working on this work and great excitement to do that, but we haven't tested on the latest version of Android.
Thank you. Question from Joanna. Is there a plan to make this work with other browsers as well?
Yeah, that's a good question. Very good question. We use the Android default browser for our work and experiments. This could be tested on other browsers as well, and I think it would be very interesting to see the comparison and how this behaves. But in our work, we haven't focused on different browsers. We just focused on the Android default browser, and we did all this work, and we pioneered basically this this work and result into this field. But it's very interesting to look into other browsers as well.
Thank you. A question from Robert. Any guidelines for using HTML links instead of JavaScript? Can you go into a little bit more detail on that?
Yeah. So as we saw, as I presented in our work, and we showed that basically the JavaScript, it consumes a lot of energy to render the web page. So we found that basically using the links, the HTML links instead of JavaScript greatly reduces this rendering energy for the page. So JavaScript web components are expensive, specifically if they are not if they are used, you know, have a lot of code and information that is not used specifically for that web page. So we highly recommend that any additional code that is not specifically used for that web page is good to be removed and not used. So we gave concrete examples of how the JavaScript components affect the web pages, and please have a look in detail on the slide, and as well we have a detailed report with more experiments and details explanations regarding the experiments. We, Yasmina is going to give more information after this talk.
Perfect. And yes, folks, I'll just add really quickly, we have already been pushing out links to you all to access the additional material that Dr. Nicowata has made available for you all on her research. So a lot of your questions, you can read more detail that can help you answer those as well in that material. You can also look in your green resource widget, which is the green file folder, for a list of all the material there. Okay, just a couple more questions here. We have a question from Paul, Dr. Nicowata, who asks, when measuring energy consumption, especially on a page that has dynamic content, when do you stop the measurement? How long a time was used to make energy measurements on a specific page?
Right. So dynamic web pages are not possible to be cached. So that's one of the important things. They're always requesting a specific link, you know, they are loading an additional link to that, and this is very hard to be measured. So we, as you can see in our experiments, in the slide number 11, just a moment, I'm going to go to that slide. Okay, so in the slide number 11, we showed basically just one moment to find the right experiment. So we basically noticed that the out of 25 websites that we actually looked into it, the most popular one, we only include 10 of the 25 because for the remaining 15 sites, caching web components did not prevent the network traffic. So if you want to measure a very good, you know, precise energy consumption for dynamic web pages, this is actually very hard because it's always going to access, it's going to download the page that is continuously accessing dynamically that specific the page. So having a dynamic web page does not allow to have a precise energy measurement for it. So if you are able to cache the all components of a web page and then measure them precisely, that this is actually the way to measure in the most precisely way.
Thank you. Next question here from Eason, who asks, any measurements done to see the difference between loading an email and rendering it and loading an image but not displaying it?
Okay. Yasmina, are you kind to repeat the question, please?
Yes. Any measurements done to see the difference between loading an email and rendering it and loading an image but not displaying it?
Right. So when regarding the images, so we have extensive measurements with basically load a complete web page, which contains web elements of type images as well. Now, the next step is if you want to measure how much is to render a specific image, is that you are going to, we commented that image in the web page, and we measure the cost of rendering the web page without the image component into the web page. And the difference between these two represents the energy consumption for the image itself. So regarding the images, that could be a very clear way of measuring precise energy consumption for images. And as we made in the last part of the experiment, so we took several type of image formats and we put them into a single web page and nothing else, and then we basically measure how much energy is consumed to render the images of several formats. So in case of images can be very, we can precisely measure the energy consumption of three types of images, in our case, GIF, PNG, and JPEG, to render the energy consumption. Now, regarding the first point that you mentioned regarding the email, we measure how much energy consumes in case of Gmail, and we showed the concrete numbers on slide number 11 and the next slide as well. So yes, we look into the email, and in our case, it's Gmail.
Super. And we will take one final question, folks. This one from Joanna. She asks, do you have any guidance around how much energy should a web page consume in order for it to be considered well-performing in terms of battery consumption?
Okay. Very good question, Johanna. So as you can see, there are several several numbers, key numbers here that we have presented in our work. So one of the costs, and we consider a high cost, energy cost, is, for example, the communication setup cost, which is 12 joules, roughly 12 joules. We consider 12 joules to be a high energy cost. Now, as smaller joules as possible, it's the best for the mobile device. Now, how much is this joules? It depends, of course, on the web components that are used and what operations are used. For example, one important thing is the average power consumption when the browser is idle, and this is something at the borderline, and we, in our experience, I showed that is 170 milliwatts. So we completely exclude that from all the rest. Now, regarding your question, as minimum joules that is consumed as better will be for saving energy on a mobile device. And roughly a very, very few joules is best for the energy consumption on a mobile device.
Perfect. And with that, folks, we are going to say a very big thank you to you, Dr. Nicoara, for spending time with us today and for presenting a really fascinating and outstanding webcast for us all.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you for having me. And, Jasmina, I just wish to mention a few more words at the end.
Yes.
So, guys, this is for most of you which are interested in our work. We have published our work in the ACM World Wide Web Conference Proceedings in Lyon, France, so which I have presented last year in 2012. So for those of you interested, you can have a look of our publication. It explains in very detail all our experiments. It gives you a very detailed information about the numbers, the joules, and all this data that I have presented today. Please feel free to let us know if you have any further questions.
Super. And, folks, just to add a little bit more to that, we did push out the link to you for that conference talk that Dr. Nicoara gave, and also in that green resource folder, a lot more information. There's an extensive interview she did with the BBC, and it's very fascinating information there, as well as lots of good information from the 2012 conference that she talked at, again, in Lyon, France, and good pictures there also, too, so you can take a look at the folks who participated. I'd like to let you all know that Dr. Nicoara is going to speak live at O'Reilly's Fluent Conference next week. So our Fluent Conference begins on May 28th and goes through the 30th in San Francisco. Dr. Nicoara's session is on May 29th. We still have some tickets available, and we can get you a good price, a good discount, as a thank you for attending our webcast today. So we pushed out details to you as well on that, and we hope you take advantage, because if you like what you saw today and heard Dr. Nicoara talk about, she will be live, and you can really pay attention to that session in person, as well as possibly meet her and shake her hand. Again, Dr. Nicoara, thank you so much for joining us today and for a very fascinating webcast. Folks that attended, thank you so much for attending our event. And to those of you that sent in your questions, thank you for those questions, because having them just adds so much more to our events, and we really do appreciate it. This will conclude our webcast for today. Goodbye, everybody.
Thank you very much. Goodbye, everybody.